Happy Sabbath. I got an email at the beginning of this week from someone who asked me a question. I get questions all the time. And this question was, do you know of any statements that describe the Son of God being elevated before he came to this earth? I said, elevated? Well, I went looking. That's a hard one. You don't see that word used very much. So, but I did find quite a bit on exalted. And in the study of that word and searching for it, I found a lot of things that I thought would be of interest to you. It was interesting to me. Encouraging to all of us. I'd like to start, if you direct your attention to Exodus chapter 15. Let's turn to Exodus 15. And I'm going to give a little instruction up here to the folks, if they can hear me. Up the top, please lower. Thank you very much. Exalted. Exalting. There are a lot of different exaltation, different forms of that word. The story here in Exodus 15 is the children of Israel. They have just left Egypt, halfway on their journey to a weekend of rest. They have encountered an obstacle. I was talking about an obstacle just a little while ago. Here was one. It was a wall. It was going to become a wall of water. They ran into the Red Sea. And right behind them in hot pursuit was the Egyptian army. Pharaoh leading the charge with 600 of his chariots of iron. And they're closing in quickly. They see the cloud of dust off in the distance there as they're shortening the distance. And the cry goes up, oh dear, now what? Well, you know the story. They are saved. Again, they've been delivered once already, and now they're going to be delivered again. And chapter 15 is the song of Moses, it says. Moses and the children of Israel sang this song, and it begins with this. I will sing unto the Lord for... I don't know how the melody went. I'm making this up, but I'm sure they had some tune for it. I will sing unto the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. That's something to sing about, isn't it? When he triumphs, and you see him triumph, you want to shout for joy. And that's what they're doing. They are rejoicing. The horse and his rider has he thrown into the sea. The Lord is my strength and my song. I'm going to get to that one a little bit later here. He is my salvation. He is my God. I will prepare him a habitation, my father's God, and I will exalt him. You going to sing that? There's a song. Oh, we have a song for that. I will exalt him. They're singing. Exaltation to their deliverer, the one who set them free again. Now, they're gathered there on the shore to sing this song. They've been saved once before. Here's the text that, I don't know why it's not up on this side now. I don't know. I've tried to get these. You can look over here. Everyone else is seeing it. That's fine. Back when they were leaving the first time in Egypt, remember it was Passover, the very last time, the last plague, 10 plagues, and God's going to deliver them. How did he do that? It was Passover. And in chapter 12, verse 23, the Lord said, I will pass over the door. Here's why we call it Passover. And will not suffer the destroyer to come in unto your houses to smite you. You have the picture? They had to sacrifice a lamb. They took the blood of that lamb and with a sprig of hyssop painted it over the lintel and side posts of their dwellings. It was a sign. And God said, when I see the blood, I will pass over the door and will not suffer the destroyer to come in to your house. How's he going to do that? Yeah, you got the picture there. He's barring the door. He's going to put himself between the destroyer and them. The destroyer would have to come through him to get to you. And that's exactly what happened at the Red Sea. 3.5 days later, it's midnight, it's dark now, it's nighttime, and the Egyptians are coming. And chapter 14 tells this part of the story. It says, the angel of the Lord who was leading them out of Egypt, which went before the camp of Israel, moved. Now, moved from where? Where was this angel? It was in that pillar of cloud by day and fire by night. So it's nighttime. It's a pillar of fire. And the pillar of cloud went from before their face and stood behind them. And it came between the camp of the Egyptians and the camp of Israel. And it was a cloud and darkness to them, the Egyptians. But it gave light by night. It was a pillar of fire. Light to those, to these, the children of Israel. So that one came not near the other all night long. They were separated. It's going to be a separation at the end of time, isn't there? There will be two groups, only two groups. And they're going to be separated. And who's in between? Angel of the Lord is going to be back. They're being called to the, what does it say? To the great day of God Almighty. To the battle of Armageddon. Harmageddon, the Mount of Megiddo. And there's going to be an attempt once again to destroy those on the Lord's side. But he's going to be protecting them. She was a second-class wife, barren, no children of her own, but now her prayer has been answered. She raises her voice in praise, and Hannah sings the song of Moses and the Lamb. It's the same song. Oh, look at this. My heart rejoices in the Lord. My horn, she's talking about, what's the horn symbol of? Power. My power is exalted. What was her power before this? What power did she have? She didn't have any children. That's the power she's talking about. My mouth is enlarged over mine enemies. Who's her enemies? Well, she's got a competition. A wife that, like Leah was second choice. Rachel was the first choice. But she was barren. Oh, here's another barren, and she got a second wife. It's her enemy. And she taunts her. I can have children. You can't. But I rejoice in my salvation. There is none holy as the Lord, for there is none beside thee. Neither is there any rock like our God. The Lord is a God of knowledge. He knows what you're going through. He knows the trouble you're facing. He knows. The bows of the mighty men are broken. The barren hath borne 7, and she that hath many children is waxed feeble. He raises up the poor out of the dust and lifts up the beggar from the dunghill to set them among princes to make them inherit the throne of glory. Wow. Where is that? From one extreme to another, isn't it? The adversaries of the Lord shall be broken to pieces. Out of heaven shall he thunder upon them. The Lord shall judge the ends of the earth, and he shall give strength unto his king and exalt the horn of his anointed. There's that word horn again. The power of his anointed. She begins by talking about her power and how it's been exalted, but she ends by recognizing that his king, his anointed, is going to be exalted. That's why she is, because he knows. He knows her problem. Well, who's the anointed? She's been exalted. The Lord has exalted her power. And what power was that? To bring forth a son. The Lord's anointed is going to be exalted with power because he is the Son. And here it is, Psalm 2. Why do the heathen rage and the people imagine a vain thing? These are the enemies of God, aren't they? So Hannah's talking about the enemies and how they're going to be brought low. She says, talks about, the adversary should be broken in pieces. Okay. The kings of the earth set themselves, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed. There's two here that it's talked about, mentioned. The Lord and his anointed. Well, who's the anointed one? In verse 6, he says, I will set my king upon my holy hill. There's that king that Hannah was singing about in her version of the Song of Moses. His king, and exalt the horn of his anointed. That's the way she ends. Well, in verse 7, it says, I will declare the decree. The Lord has said unto me, thou art my son. This day have I begotten thee. This is his king. This is the Lord's king, the Lord's anointed. And he's going to exalt him above all the kings of the earth. Is there anyone who's been exalted above all the kings of the earth? The Lord's anointed is going to be. The Lord has in his anointed. Well, you know, this is not only in Psalm 2. This was a cherished verse. Acts chapter 4. The disciples, after they gathered again in the upper room, after Peter and John had raised the lame man at the gate, beautiful, remember the story? And he went leaping and jumping and praising God. You remember that story? And then he hauled him off. Hauled them off before the Sanhedrin. They threw him in the jail. And the next day, they said, don't you teach in his name? And Peter says, there's no other name under heaven by which men can be saved. What do you mean we can't teach in his name? We're going to respect God rather than men. And they came back to the upper room, and they quoted this verse from Psalm chapter 2. Now, in Acts 4, it says, why did the heathen rage? Well, it's the same as in Psalm 2, right? Why did? Yeah, in Psalm it says, why do the heathen rage? In Acts they say, why did the heathen rage? If you could show the people out there in the internet land, they could see that text side by side with Psalm 2, it'd sure be nice. Why did the heathen rage and the people imagine vain things? There we go. The kings of the earth stood up, and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against his Christ. Well, this is New Testament language because it's written in Greek, so they use the word Christ. Hebrew, anointed, Messiah. Same thing. For a truth against thy holy child Jesus, whom thou hast anointed. There he says it, see? The Lord's anointed is his begotten Son. Psalm 18. Let's turn to that. I don't have a slide for this one. Let's just turn to it. Psalm 18, verse 46. This is a song. Maybe you know this one. Psalm 18, verse 46. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and may the God of my salvation be exalted. Exalted. Why should he be exalted? Because he is worthy to receive honor and blessing and praise and strength and power and all those things in Revelation chapter 5 that all the angels in heaven, 24 elders, the four beasts, everybody's bowing down and giving honor. You're exalting the Lord and his anointed, his Son. For all the things that he has done, for all that he is doing and all that he is going to do for us. Psalm 118 says in verse 26, and we're in Psalms, it won't take too long to get over to there. Psalm 118 is the middle chapter in the Bible, you know that. Psalm 117 is the shortest chapter, and Psalm 119 is the longest chapter, but Psalm 118 is the middle chapter. Verse 26, blessed be he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Jesus quoted this several times. You remember when he left the temple for the last time. This is Matthew 23. Last verse, verse 39, Matthew 23, let's turn there real quick, it's not hard to do. Matthew 23, last verse, 29, now right before this famous verse, you know this, O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, thou that killest the prophets, stones them that sent unto thee, how often I would have gathered thy children together as a hen gathers her chicks, and you would not. Behold, your house, what is their house? The temple. He is left unto you desolate. Why is it desolate? Because he's not going to be there anymore. He's leaving. For I say, now here comes the verse. This is the last verse. For I say unto you, you shall not see me anymore until you shall say, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. He quoted Psalm 118, verse 26. Now, when is he going to do that? When is that going to happen when everyone says, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord? When the heavens split open as a scroll and Jesus comes with all his angels sitting on the right hand of glory and with the glory of his Father. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Now, if we go back a couple of chapters, let's go back to chapter 21. He says this again in verse 9. He is on his way preparing to enter into Jerusalem. Remember, people are excited now. They had tried to crown him king down at the Sea of Galilee. And he shooed him off, told him to go home, he got in the boat and went across the sea. Boy, were they disappointed. They have tried to make him king, and now, finally, he's going to let them do it. Looks like it. Get a colt. That's what kings do. They got to ride into the city on a colt. Get a colt. They're putting the palm branches down there. They're putting their robes down out there in a path for him to ride. And a great, very great multitude, verse 8, spread their garments in the way. Put palm branches down, verse 9. And the multitudes went before him, and they cried, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Now they're quoting the verse. It's that time. That's when this is, that this verse is about when the Messiah is going to come. And here he is. He's coming. Hosanna in the highest. John 5:43. Let's see this one here. John 5, Jesus is talking he was at the pool of Bethesda. And after healing that man at the pool of Bethesda, he was attacked. They were going to kill him. They sought to slay him because he did all that on the Sabbath day. In verse 43, he says, I am come in my Father's name. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Did Jesus come in the name of the Lord? He said he did. He came the first time in his Father's name. And he's going to come the second time in his Father's name. And in his Father's glory, sitting on the right hand of power, his Father's power. He's going to be exalted. Solomon exalted when he built and was dedicating the temple, Solomon's temple, the second temple. And read about it. It's an inspiring prayer. It's a long one, but we'll just look at a few verses here. First Chronicles chapter 29, starting with verse 10. Oh, this is David. Yeah, this is David's prayer. Solomon gave a prayer. It's very similar. David's giving a prayer. He exhorts the people. He calls all the people together, and he says, Solomon is going to be king. And so David blesses the people. They're all gathered there. They're rejoicing greatly, verse 9. And he said, Blessed be thou, Lord God of Israel, our Father, forever and ever. Thine, O Lord, is the greatness. You know, the Lord's Prayer ends in that, doesn't it? For thine is the greatness and the power and the glory forever. You'll see a lot of that in here. And the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty for all. Oh, we ought to put this on the slide. Here we go. For all that is in the heaven and in the earth is thine. Thine is the kingdom, O Lord, and thou art exalted as head above all. Exalted. He is worthy to be exalted as head above all. Both riches and honor come from you. He is the source of all things. You reign over all, and in your hand is power and might. And in your hand it is to make great and to give strength unto all. Now, therefore, our God, we thank thee and praise your glorious name. What a prayer. Do we exalt our Father enough? I think of all the things we pray for. We do a lot of requesting and asking. And he tells us, ask, and ye shall receive. We're told to do that. I think he loves to hear us come to him and ask. because it is His pleasure to give. He is the great giver. John the Baptist talked about exaltation. Now, it was prophesied that he would. Let's turn to Isaiah chapter 40. Isaiah chapter 40. Oh, I was going to mention this. This is from 20th volume of manuscript releases. What is justification by faith? It is the work of God in laying the glory of man in the dust and doing for man that which is not in his power to do for himself. What can you do for yourself anyway? Isn't that what Jesus said? I can of mine own self do nothing. If Jesus could do nothing of himself, why do we think we can do anything? When men see their own nothingness, they are prepared to be clothed with the righteousness of Christ. Now you're ready. When you recognize that you have... what is the sign? Rock of Ages. In my hand, no, simply to thy cross I bring. In my hand, no, huh? No price I bring, simply to thy cross I cling. Yeah. We have nothing to offer, we have nothing to bring, but He owns the cattle on a thousand hills. And He is the source of all things. He can then do for us which we cannot do for our own selves. Isaiah 40, verse 3, talked about, this is a prophecy of John the Baptist. The voice of him that crieth in the wilderness. When they came to him down in the Jordan, and they asked him, who are you? Are you Elijah? No, I'm not Elijah. Are you that prophet that Moses talked about in Deuteronomy chapter 18, verse 18, that Moses said would come one like myself? No, not him. Well, then who are you? He says, I am the voice of him that crieth in the wilderness. Prepare ye the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be exalted, sang Handel and his Messiah. And every mountain and every hill shall be made low. You see the contrast. Where are the valleys? They're low already. But what's going to happen to the valleys? They're going to be exalted. What about the mountains? Where are the mountains? Oh, they're up high. What's going to happen to them? They're going to be made low. There's a lesson in this, and Jesus talked about it a number of times. The crooked should be made straight, and the rough places plain, made plain. And this is what John the Baptist came to do, to prepare the way for his cousin, the Messiah. And Jesus said of John the Baptist that there was none born of a woman any greater than he in the kingdom of heaven. And yet, he is least among men. He didn't elevate himself. He didn't exalt himself. But he said what? He must increase. He's talking about Jesus. He must increase. I must decrease. There are people in the Bible, however, in my study of exaltation, that did exalt themselves. Now we're in Isaiah. I guess we can go back a few chapters, Isaiah 14. What did Lucifer say? I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. That's pretty ambitious. He had big plans, didn't he? 1 Kings chapter 1, verse 5 tells a story about Adonijah, one of David's sons, a type of Lucifer, who said, I will be king. And he exalted himself. That's what Lucifer did, right? He just said that. I will exalt my throne. He says, I'm going to be king on a throne. I will exalt myself as well. Daniel 11, verse 36, talks about another version of this little horn power being described. It says, this king shall do according to his will. He shall exalt himself. Now, this is not Lucifer, but it's got the principles of Lucifer all through him, doesn't he? And magnify himself above every god. Sitting in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. At least that's what he claims. Well, Jesus described this problem of exaltation, and it was a problem. It's a blessing and a problem. It's a blessing when he exalts, and it's a blessing for us when we exalt him. It's a curse when we try to exalt ourselves. And Jesus warned against this. Luke chapter 14, he tells, I don't know if it's a parable, but he's giving some advice. He says, when you're invited to a wedding or to any special occasion, and there's going to be important people there, watch out. Don't think yourself so important that you can march up to the front row and take the first best seat. Let me give you some advice, Jesus said. Rather, sit down in the lowest room or in the back of the room. Sit down, don't be in the spotlight. Sit in the back row. Then, when he that invited you comes in and he sees you back there, he might say, oh, you shouldn't be sitting here. I got a better place for you. Let me move you up. You get an upgrade. It's almost much better to get an upgrade than to get a tap on the shoulder and say, excuse me, we've got somewhere back here for you. That's not very... You don't want to put yourself in that position. So Jesus gave that advice. And he said, he might come up to you and say, friend, go up higher. What is that? Is that exalting? You're being exalted. And you will have honor in the presence of those that sit with you. And then he ends by saying, for, here's his moral of the story is, whosoever exalts himself shall be abased. What does that mean? Brought low. Every mountain shall be brought low. And he that humbles himself shall be exalted. Every valley shall be exalted. Well, that was one time. Now, just four chapters later, chapter 18, he tells this parable about the story of the Pharisee and the publican in the temple. They come to pray, and the Pharisee, he says, prays to himself. I'm so thankful I'm not like this guy over here who has to eke out a living charging exorbitant prices, taxes. He's a tax collector, a publican. He's working for the state. He's just a state worker, a public servant. I don't know what they called him back then. I'm on the higher level of the ladder of success, because God has blessed me. And he's praying to himself the whole time, apparently. And then Jesus says, the publican, standing afar off, he didn't even come up to the front, he's in the corner, wouldn't lift up so much his eyes to heaven, he smote his breast and cried out, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. He recognized who he was, where he was. And Jesus said, I tell you, this man went down to his house justified Now, we read that quote just a little while ago. What's justification by faith? It's God doing for man. It's laying the glory of man in the dust and doing for him what he cannot do for himself. Could this man do anything? He recognized he couldn't. And he asked for mercy. He's praying for mercy. He wants to be freed from his bondage of sin. Is his prayer answered? Jesus says it was. He goes home justified rather than the other one. For everyone that exalts himself shall be abased. He's saying the same thing again. And he that humbles himself shall be exalted. Well, there's one more time he's going to say this. This one's in Matthew chapter 23. He says, call no man your father upon earth. Don't set people up on a pedestal and make them higher than everybody else. For there is one who is your father, which is in heaven. Neither be ye called masters, for one is your master, even Christ. So you have one Father and one Master, the Lord and His anointed, the Father and His Son. And then he says, and all ye are brethren. For he that is greatest among you shall be your servant, and whoever shall exalt himself shall be abased, and he that shall humble himself shall be exalted. So in three different settings and in three different contexts, Jesus applies this maxim, cautioning us about exaltation, self-exaltation, encouraging us to be humble, except you become as little children. You cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. Capernaum, you are exalted unto heaven. Jesus said, but you will be brought down to hell. Now, why? What did Capernaum do to deserve that? Why was Capernaum exalted to heaven? The same reason that when Jesus left the temple, it was left desolate. Because Capernaum is called in the Gospels his city. It was the city that Jesus spent much and perhaps most of his time at. Matthew 11 is where he says this. And he goes on to say, for if the mighty works which were done in Capernaum... Oh, there were mighty works done in Capernaum. Were done in Sodom. Sodom would have remained until this day. Sodom would have accepted him, he's saying. What happened to Capernaum? Maybe they didn't accept Jesus. It's interesting, but when I went looking for all the... details about Capernaum. Where is it found in the Gospels? First place is in Matthew chapter 4. It tells us that it's on the Sea of Galilee of the Gentiles. Matthew 4:13. And you read on what happened there. It goes on down to about verse 16. Jesus, it says, Capernaum is of the Gentiles. It's a Gentile city. People that sat in darkness, he's quoting Isaiah. And they shall see a great light. Who was that great light? They saw it. They saw the light that came into the world that lit every man. And he healed Peter's mother. Well, Peter lived there in Capernaum, apparently. And his wife's mother was sick. She had a fever. They came home from the synagogue on Sabbath, and Jesus healed her. And that evening, when the sun went down, it says all the people came, flocked in for him to heal, and he healed all of them. So a lot of great works were done in Capernaum. Well, that's not all. Let's read on here. Matthew 8 tells this story as well. There's Peter's house. There it is. He healed Peter's mother-in-law. Uh-oh, you want the verse again? Well, okay, I'll find it. You just scan down through there. You'll see it. let's see here. Adultery, Matthew 8. Oh, I've got to get 8 here. 8, Matthew 8. 14. But before that, let's go up here to Capernaum. Yeah, Capernaum's by the Sea of Galilee. And the... mountain, where did I see that? Oh, boy. I did a search here. I did all the searches for Capernaum. Okay, you want to make me do this? All right, here we go. Capernaum. 16 times it's found. Leaving Nazareth, he went to dwell in Capernaum. Matthew 4, 8. Jesus went and he entered into Capernaum. Verse 5. There it is. Okay. And he heals the centurion's servant who's sick with palsy. And he comes and he says, Jesus says, I'll come and heal him. And he says, no, don't need to do that. Just speak the word. You're a man of authority. I'm a man of authority. I command people do things. You command and it'll happen. I believe it. That's great work he did there in Capernaum. Then he comes home, verse 14, to Peter's house. Heals Peter's mother-in-law. And all the people that evening. And the tribute money, the fish's mouth. Oh, my. Okay, you want me to search? You want the verse, the text and verse? Okay, here we go. I should have written these down. That's Matthew 17, 24. Received the tribute money. Remember, Peter says, yeah, my master pays taxes. And he says, no, wait a minute. Do the children of the king pay taxes? Okay, so that they might know that we are law-abiding, says, you go down, catch yourself a fish, and open its mouth, and you'll find the tax money, which he did. And then there was a man with an unclean spirit in the synagogue, and that's on the Sabbath day, Mark chapter 1, verse 21. And the man, you remember that when they took the tiles off the roof and they let the man down through the roof? Because there was no room in the house, it was standing room only, it couldn't get this guy in through the door, so they went up on top of the roof, let him down. That happened in Capernaum. And that is in, let's find where that is, Mark chapter 2. And verse 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 or so. Let him down through the roof. And then in John chapter 6. Now, John chapter 6 is where Jesus had just fed 5,000. It's getting close to Passover. And there's going to be a feast of unleavened bread. Well, he gave them unleavened bread. And lots of it. They had 12 baskets left over. And they said, let's make you king. And they're going to make him king. And he goes across the sea. There's a whole story and the storm on the sea and everything. And they find him on the other side. How'd you get here? And they ask a question. And he said, give us the bread of heaven. Oh, they're still on this bread thing. They had fixated on the bread. Moses gave our fathers bread in the wilderness. He said, Moses didn't do that. My father gave you that bread. And he is giving you the bread of heaven, the living bread. I am that bread. That's what all this is for. These were all to teach you lessons. And they have this long, whole chapter 6 about this. And he says, you're to feed on my words, receive me, believe on me. You won't thirst anymore. You won't hunger anymore. You got to eat my flesh. You got to drink my blood. Oh, you know, he's mixing a lot of stuff here. And people weren't sure about this. This was in Capernaum where all this happened. And it says they left him not to follow him anymore. They didn't follow him. And he turned to the disciples and said, are you going to leave too? And Peter says, where shall we go? You have the words of life. And that's where Jesus says, the words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. Capernaum. A lot of things happened in Capernaum. But the evidence is that they did not fully accept the bread from heaven. And Jesus said, unless you do, you will have no life in you. He that eats the flesh of the Son of Man shall live forever. He's not talking about physically eating his flesh, but accepting him into your life. Listening to his words. Let them become part of your life. There's a danger in exalting ourselves. Now, Capernaum was exalted. He said, unto heaven. What happens when we exalt ourselves? Let's turn to Hosea chapter 13. Hosea. Now, that's in the Old Testament. It's one right after Daniel. Daniel, Hosea. Hosea 13's last chapter. No, oh, next to the last chapter. Chapter 13, verse 6. Verse 4 is pretty good. I am the Lord thy God from the land of Egypt. That you shall know no God but me, for there is no Savior besides myself. I knew you in the wilderness, in the land of great drought. According to their pastures, so they were filled. They were filled with what? Manna and quail. And their heart was exalted. Now what happens when you exalt your heart? Therefore have they forgotten me. That's the danger in exalting ourselves. When we become so important in our own eyes, we forget where our life, our strength, our blessing, our exaltation comes from. We can't exalt ourselves. But he can exalt us. And he will. Isaiah 2:17. It says, the loftiness of man shall be humbled, and the haughtiness of man shall be made low. Every mountain shall be made low, right? And the Lord alone shall be exalted in that day. Who's going to be exalted? The Lord. And the idols he shall utterly abolish. Why? What were the idols? Were they being exalted? Yeah, people were exalting the idols. And they shall go into the holes of the rocks and into the caves of the earth. Ooh, what does this sound like? For the fear of the Lord and for the glory of his majesty, when he shall arise to shake terribly the earth. Sounds like Revelation chapter 6, right? The last couple of verses there. Then shall the kings and the bondman and the ever-free man call for the rocks and the mountains to fall on them and hide them from the face of him that sitteth upon the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. An angry Lamb. Humble yourselves. Don't exalt yourself. 1 Peter 5, 6. Oh, here it is. Humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God. Now, I've repeated it here for the sake of the song that we're going to sing. But humble yourselves that he may exalt you in due time. Who's going to exalt us? He will. The mighty hand of God will exalt us. Casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God. Humble yourselves that he may exalt you in due time. You know that song? Okay, let's sing it. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God. Humble yourself that he may exalt you in due time. Casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God. Humble yourselves that he may exalt you in due time. Well, I was a little loud there, but it's exalting. But we're not exalting ourselves. He's going to exalt us. We humble ourselves. That's our assignment. If you so accept it, mission impossible. That's the mission possible. That's what Jesus did. Isn't that what Jesus did? Philippians 2, 6. Who being in the form of God was equal with God, but he humbled himself. Being found in the fashion of a man, taking the form of a servant, he was obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Therefore has God highly exalted him, verse 9, and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, what? Every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess that he is the Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Peter said this on the day of Pentecost, that Jesus Christ, that God raised up, therefore being by the right hand of God exalted, he has received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit and has shed this forth. God has made him Lord and Christ. In Acts chapter 5, he said, God has Him has God exalted with his right hand to be a prince and a savior, to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. God has exalted him because he humbled himself. It's the promise that he gives to us. Ephesians chapter 1 and chapter 2, but starting with verse 17, chapter 1, the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, according to the works of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places, has put all things under his feet and given him to be the head over all things to the church. That's how he exalted his son. And in chapter 2, he says, well, how he's going to exalt us. Beginning in verse 5, even when we were dead in sins. When Jesus was dead and He raised Him from the dead. We're dead in our sins. So He quickens us. He's going to raise us up from the dead together with Christ, and has raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. There's exaltation. But that's something that God will do. It's not what we will do. Our assignment, boys and girls, is to humble ourselves and exalt Him, exalt His name. His name is above every name. And what a day that's going to be when all flesh shall see His glory together. Every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord to the glory of His Father. Let's pray as we close. Thank You, Father, for all that You are, for all that You have done for us through Your Son, in giving Him everything, in giving Him all of Your Spirit, all of Your life, that He might have life in Himself, that He might raise us up from the dead and from our deadness of our sins. We ask that You lay our glory in the dust. Make us glory only in You and in Your Son. And we ask that His name be honored in all that we do and all that we say. We know that there is so much that needs to be done in this world. We pray for Your power to be manifest and seen in the lives of those who have humbled themselves. May we glory only in what You do and what You have done and what You're going to do. We ask that we will be able to see Your glory when You reveal it to all flesh. We pray this in the name of Your Son, Jesus. Amen.